Hola, and welcome to Vive Nutrition Radio, the first ever Spanglish podcast where you will hear interviews with the top minds in nutrition, performance, fitness, and health in both English and Spanish. Here is your host, expert registered dietitian, Andres Ayesta, on a mission to help you take your nutrition to the next level. Hope you're ready for this. Let's dive right in.
What is going on, boys and girls? Welcome back to another episode of Vive Nutrition Radio. This is your host, Andres Ayesta, registered dietitian and nutrition expert. But you already heard that on the intro, so no need to reiterate that. I want to give you a little overview of today's podcast, which was amazing. You definitely need to listen to this one if you want to hear all about gut health. I had the pleasure to interview Dr. Gabrielle Fundaro. She is a worldwide star because her resume is incredible. She has a PhD in human nutrition, food, and exercise from Virginia Tech. She studied a lot the effects of probiotic supplementation of metabolic dysregulation during high-fat feeding. She's currently a Renaissance periodization coach, ISSN-certified sports nutritionist. She's a certified health coach. And Dr. Fundaro, or Gabrielle, is also she used to be a former assistant professor at exercise science at Georgia Gwinnett College. And like I said, she holds a PhD from Virginia Tech. She actually also competed in bikini and women's physique. She's done powerlifting meets. Like, she's been doing all around everything. So she's a smart cookie. In today's conversation, we talked a lot about gut health, specifically about probiotics and whether they're not, they're hype or they live up to their hype. We talked about microbiome testing and whether or not that's something you should be spending money on and whether the results that you get from those testing actually give you any kind of good data for you to be able to make changes. We talked about garlic and onions, and you're going to have to listen to the podcast to understand why that's something important to consider. And overall, we had a really pleasant conversation and busting myths and talking about nutrition research and how it sometimes becomes so misinterpreted in social media and media outlets. The overall picture of it is the fact that we're so impatient in research and microbiome and gut health. It's so understudied, not understudied. It's just so vast that there's still a lot of information that is still needed. And of course, we're not patient enough to see this through. So we try to obviously place it, or at least the nutrition industry try to place it on whatever study we can kind of hold on to really overextend it and really think that this is going to be the solution to your problem. We went, like I said, from probiotics to even fecal transplants. We didn't really get too much into that, but you're going to have to listen to the whole podcast to understand exactly what we talked about. So hope you enjoy this conversation with Dr. Gabrielle Fundaro, also known as on Instagram as Vitamin PhD. See you guys in the next one. Enjoy. All right, Gabrielle, welcome to the show. I'm going to call you, I don't know if you like to be called Dr. Fundaro or you like formalities, or you to call you like Gabrielle. Like, you know, what did you prefer for me to refer to you as during this podcast?
Oh, Gabrielle is totally fine. All formalities aside.
That's awesome. Well, welcome to the show, and thank you so much for taking the time to be on here on Vive Nutrition Radio today. You are obviously pretty famous on Instagram, mainly because of the fact that you are a myth buster, and this is exactly what we're going to be talking about today. But before we get started, why don't you kind of give us a little bit of your background? Because anytime that I talk to somebody that has done as much nutrition research and as much nutrition education to the level of a PhD, I like to know where that started. So what's your story?
Oh, awesome. Well, thank you so much for the kind words. I don't know if I would say famous, but I'm glad that people like my myth busting and that's gaining some traction. So I actually started out with my bachelor's in exercise, sport, and health education. So I really had a passion for educating in the sciences early on. And I tutored a lot with anatomy and physiology and loved teaching so much that I decided that I was going to go on to pursue a PhD specifically so that I could you know, be a professor one day, because I looked up to mine so much. So I did my internship actually as like a research assistant in a skeletal muscle physiology and biochem lab, and that's where I eventually did my PhD. So the area of my PhD, the lab that I was in, we were actually focused on skeletal muscle metabolism specifically. Mm-hmm. And I was curious to a fault. And so I was really wondering all the time why we were injecting mice with something called LPS or lipopolysaccharide. Mm-hmm. We would do this and then we'd basically look at the change in functionality of their skeletal muscle. And I was like, why are we using LPS? Like, what is this supposed to be a model of? And it was because it bound to a specific receptor that we looked at, toll-like receptor 4, which is part of our immune system that responds to specific structures associated with pathogens. Mm-hmm. And so long story short, we ended up having an opportunity to do some probiotics research. And the reason that that's related to the whole LPS thing is that lipopolysaccharide actually comes from specific bacteria that are housed in our digestive tract. And when those bacteria die, they release that compound. It can then exit the gastrointestinal tract and enter circulation and bind to these receptors on skeletal muscle. And that tends to happen more often in individuals who have obesity and or who are eating a high-fat diet. So what we were really modeling with LPS injections was something called metabolic endotoxemia. It's basically circulating levels of LPS that lead to sort of a low-grade systemic inflammation. And I am very much about getting to the root cause of something. And so I wanted to know, you know, how could we prevent this rather than just looking at the effects? And so when we had the opportunity to, you know, do some work with probiotic supplementation, I took that on. And we then examined the potential protective role of probiotics against some of these issues. And they really don't confer any benefit when it comes to controlling obesity. Yeah. What we see most often is, you know, some maintenance of like a very modest maintenance of insulin sensitivity in rodents and humans. But overall, you just can't slap a probiotic on it and then, you know, think that it's going to be your Band-Aid.
You jump right ahead of the entire podcast. So there you go, folks. Like, probiotics do not work. No, we're going to get into like the details on that, because we definitely want to kind of hear more on, because I'm probably going to say it's a pretty multi-million dollar industry. There's a lot of people talking probiotic supplementation. I have personally taken probiotics, and as a registered dietitian, I feel like it's really important for us to be evidence-based practitioners and to be able to provide the proper information. And I feel there's a lot of dietitians that are recommending these things. I have in the past, and we just really need to know, like, are we doing the proper, are we making the proper recommendations? And I feel like that's like the main thing. And I think I saw like your dissertation when you were doing it, your PhD was literally, I'm reading here, effects of probiotic supplementation on metabolic dysregulation during high fat feeding. Mm-hmm. Was this done in animals or this was done in humans?
We actually had two arms. So the first round was done in rodents, mm-hmm. and then second round we did in humans. And so with the humans, they actually gave them, I believe it was 1,000 calorie excess per day in the form of like a milkshake. So most often, you know, with the high fat diets, especially what we were working with in the lab, we were looking at really modeling sort of the standard American diet kind of to the extreme. So high fat, refined carbohydrates, high levels of saturated fat. And we would do that both, you know, with our own studies and in humans.
Awesome. That's great. So we're going to get into some of those details because I want to ask you specific questions within that, specifically on modeling the diet and that kind of stuff. And how does that translate from the practical perspective? So to like the day-to-day human and some of those different things. But now that we're kind of talking about this, I guess like we are living in a society where it seems like we're kind of blaming like gut health for everything, it seems like. And I think like you talk a lot about that often. And I'm not sure if this is like too broad of a question to ask you, but what is kind of like your generalized perspective on the current status and the current state of affairs as far as like gut health right now? What is like, if you can kind of like summarize it in a paragraph, what is being said and what do you think the biggest problem is with that? And then obviously we'll go into some of the details, but I'm not sure if it's too broad of a question, but I want to kind of get started on really what do you think is happening at this point?
Yeah. So I think it's important to keep in mind that this field is really, really young. So it's only been for, maybe about the past decade that we've been able to use advanced methods to really identify the microbes present and also their activities. And it was really in the past also decade that we first characterized the potential role of the microbiome in obesity. And prior to this, a lot of the research was really limited because of the methods that we were using to identify the microbes present. We were generally just culturing them, and a majority of the microbes are not culturable. And so we were trying to, take a picture, think of it sort of like taking a picture of all the organisms in a jungle, but you're doing it from a helicopter. So you're going to miss a lot of detail from there. You might see a bunch of trees, and if that's all that you're going off of, you're going to be like, well, there's really not a lot down there, kind of a lot of trees. I think we saw some elephants because they're really big, but you just miss so much of the detail. And so now, we've got so much data emerging from the Human Microbiome Project, the Integrative Human Microbiome Project, the American Gut Project. So we're getting a lot more data, but the problem now is that, it's not all of equal quality and of equal detail. And because it's so new, it's become sort of a Wild West. So people can make claims because we really don't know very well what's going on, and no one can really argue against them, because in many cases, it's not necessarily that it's an evidence of absence, but we just have an absence of evidence. So it's hard to make specific recommendations and strong claims in most cases because we just don't have the data. And then where we do have data, people are conflating, finding a link with finding something that's causative. So especially when it comes to the microbiome and mental health, even if we find a link, recently there was an article that came out linking a gene mutation in the brain and the gut in rodent models of autism. And so they said, we've confirmed a link between the brain and the gut with regards to autism. Well, that doesn't mean that we've confirmed a cause. Exactly. So, but it's a hot topic and people are so excited. And so they want to be able to draw conclusions. And we just, I think, need to kind of put the brakes on to make sure that we're giving really sound recommendations.
So it sounds like I see these often. I feel like in nutrition research, especially nowadays, like there's like a lack of patience when it comes down to like the research and the application portion of things. And I was recently in a conference in Dallas, and I think his name is Professor Graham Close. He talks a lot about sports nutrition research and all that, and the misinterpretation of research studies and how things are actually completely taken out of context. And the biggest thing that I feel like is happening the most is like, okay, you take a study, and then obviously you take like the media, and you pull out the specifics of like, or like the what's it called, like the conclusions of a study to really kind of like exploit it into something because you want to give some like, I guess, like, I don't know if it's more of a hope for people, like, okay, or the next big thing. Is that kind of what you tend to see happening from like the perspective of research? And what do you think is the biggest issue that you see from translating from like the science to the application portion of things? What is the gap that we're missing at this point? Besides obviously the obvious of like, okay, we have the absence of evidence. Like we're still like waiting for some of those different areas.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was such a great way of saying it, that we really don't have patience right now, and that people, they want the next big thing and they want a conclusive statement. They want to know what to do. You know, it's not exciting enough for most people just to know, you know, that we're learning about it. They're like, okay, well, what can I do with this information? That's one of my biggest questions. What can I do for optimal gut health? And I mean, you know, there are some things that we can say with pretty strong confidence, you know, like, okay, dietary fiber, because we've seen repeated findings, you know, across multiple study designs in humans and in rodents. And we can say, okay, now there's a pattern emerging. But what often happens is we sort of get that first exposure bias. So we'll get a paper that will come out and it sounds really exciting and everyone kind of jumps on that and doesn't wait for confirmation, for replicability, to determine that those findings are actually reliable and valid. So, you know, and not to mention the positive publication bias. So, you know, how many, this is really funny. So when I went to try and publish, one of the reviewers said, if nothing changed, why are you publishing this data?
Really?
Yeah.
Like he wanted to, okay, like I'm going to publish this. It's obviously something is different. If you actually can prove something, it's like a little bit different, or at least positive on this end, right?
Yeah. Yeah. It's like if you have, you know, what they, there are sort of joke journals of negative results, as if, you know, oh, we don't see a change, that means that something went wrong or it didn't work. And no, we need studies that show, hey, that lab, you know, they found a positive result. That's great. But if it's not replicable, then I don't think that that's strong evidence. And I've seen that occur with, especially with probiotics research. In most cases, we don't have replications of initial studies, or we have replications, but you know, they're not able to reproduce the findings.
And then sometimes they're not published.
Yeah, and well, and even if they are published, I've seen, you know, I'm writing a piece now, and you know, what, been writing this RP gut science book for a while. And found a great analysis of some recent probiotics research. And they actually did sort of a net finding summary. So, you know, for example, like a lactobacillus acidophilus, a specific strain, you know, how many studies found that it was effective for pediatric diarrhea versus ineffective. So we may have two publications that show it's effective and then five that show it's not effective, but those five are not going to be shared. We're only going to share the two, even though like really the net result there is -3, in my opinion, if we have, you know, consistent findings that, hey, this is not actually doing anything and those outweigh the number that do find a difference. I just think we have to really look at the big picture. That's really my thing. Yeah. Like take all the results and sum them.
It just seems like it's all like a Netflix documentary, always with an agenda, like a journal or like a news outlet, like always with like a specific area that they want to show or prove or disprove, depending on what it is. And that's the thing, the biggest issue that we have with our society and nutrition industry right now.
Yeah.
Now, let's get into the fun part of things. So let's actually like bust and miss. So let's talk more into like the details. And I think we need to start with the area that you studied the most, which is probiotics. So why don't we kind of start with you kind of giving us an overview, or what is the premise behind using or supplementing with probiotics? Why do people do it, or why is it pushed? And then we'll get more into, you know, is it really necessary based on your research, what you found with LPS and some of those different things? Is it really beneficial for some people? Like, would you recommend it at all or not? And why?
Okay, awesome. Those are great questions. So I would say that most people take a probiotic because they hope or think that it is going to have a significant effect on the overall shape of their microbiome, so that it will enrich their gut, so to speak, with that species or multiple species or strains of bacteria in order to treat or prevent an illness or disease. So, and you know, people sort of use the term like heal the gut, heal leaky gut, or, you know, cure dysbiosis. So they're really using it almost in a medicinal way.
Okay.
That's my impression, you know, of what I see people taking it in most cases.
And just before you continue, I just wanted to make a parenthesis so we can kind of establish, because I was just thinking, it's like, okay, I want to make sure that my listeners know what probiotics and microbiome means. So why don't we kind of like establish a definition of what a probiotic means? Like, essentially, where can you get it from, a supplement versus from food sources? And then how would you define microbiome or like biodiversity in your microbiota, I guess?
Yeah. So the definition of probiotics has changed a little bit in recent years. It used to be a live microorganism that would be that could be ingested and then confer some benefit to the host. But now we know that probiotic supplements don't necessarily need to be alive to have a potential benefit. And one thing that people may not be aware of is that not all probiotics are actually bacteria, that we actually do have a very, as far as the literature is concerned, one of the most effective probiotic supplements is actually a yeast. So just a little tidbit of information
bacteria.
There. Yeah, exactly. Not a bacteria. So they are microorganisms that would confer some benefit to the host. The structure and function claims for probiotics are a little bit blurry. There are some areas in which they do appear to be very effective, but it's pretty limited, and it is strain and disease and population specific. So there's not one kitchen sink probiotic, like a multivitamin or something, that would confer general benefit to every person. So that's very important to realize. And I think that kind of gets to your question also of, you know, is it something that's helpful for everyone?
Yeah. And these now are like the broad spectrum, like probiotics that people hear all about, right?
Right.
You're saying that doesn't really apply to everybody the same way.
Exactly. And now there are foods that contain some of these probiotic bacteria. So if it's a food that's been fermented or cultured and then has not been pasteurized, because pasteurization would heat kill the bacteria, then that may contain live beneficial bacteria, although we don't know exactly what numbers we're looking at in terms of how many bacteria are present. And even though it's a really popular area and a popular recommendation, really the data on fermented foods and their benefit is just emerging. So we don't have strong evidence yet that they have a specific effect on human physiology. That's sort of just emerging.
Okay.
Now the microbiome and microbiota, those are two words that are often used interchangeably. The microbiome, you can think of that like an ecosystem. So it's all of the organisms and all of their genetic information, all their genetic material. The microbiota is just the organisms themselves.
Okay.
So it's really almost, they're often used interchangeably, but
it's like a city. It's like the way I have described it before is like, imagine like it's like a city, and then like microbiome would be the city and the microbiota would be the people that live in the city. In this case, I guess like in a way, like for people like to have like an easy kind of like clear picture of it, I guess.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, great. So, and I guess like, so what you're saying then, obviously, like first, just so people listening in understand, like there's no really like clear data on this and not enough to be able to say a probiotic, it's something that you should take or that you should do based on simply because it was just kind of recommended by a doctor or something like this, because there are different kinds. Now, is there a, like, I guess like not necessarily the benefit, but more, is there a risk from taking actual probiotics at this point for people that are like taking probiotics for like months on and stuff like that? And I have, for example, I also wanted to ask your opinion on this, because there are like super high level probiotics. Like I have heard of a company, I think I forgot the name. It's like outrageous. Like you take like 10 pills every single day for like 10 days. So yeah. Supposedly it's like, literally I'm blanking on the name, but it's supposed to be the same effect of a probiotic that you would take for 3 months, but you're only doing it for 10 days. So I want to ask you more about the risks associated with taking like overload of probiotics, and how does that really affect your microbiome?
Mm-hmm. So there actually was a really interesting article published earlier this year. I believe it came out of Israel. And they looked at the effect of probiotic supplementation after really strong antibiotics. And they compared that against wait and see, which is basically just do nothing. You just go back to your normal routine, versus something called an autologous fecal microbiota transplant. So that's where you are ingesting or via an enema your own microbiome via fecal matter. Now they process it, you know, they encapsulate it so it's safe to ingest. Mm-hmm. If provided by a doctor, you would not want to do that in your own home.
Don't encapsulate your own poop, guys. Yes, like, please, yes. Don't do that.
So they were comparing those three methods. And what they found was that the probiotic supplementation actually delayed the reestablishment of their native microbiome. And what they developed would sort of be considered dysbiosis. So to define dysbiosis, that's basically an unfavorable relative abundance of species in the gut. So if you think about an ecosystem, you want it to be diverse. So that means that we have a lot of organisms present. And you also want the relative abundance of those organisms to be in balance so that it's sort of self-sustaining. So if you think about it, if we have an invasive species enter that shouldn't be there, that can cause problems, or if we have an overabundance of predators or an overabundance of herbivores, that can throw off the balance of the entire ecosystem. Mm-hmm. So the same thing can happen in your gut. And when we have an area of really low richness, so very few organisms and low diversity, that can then give rise to dysbiosis, even if the really prevalent species and strains are considered to be beneficial. We really need to have an overall balance. We even need to have some pathogenic bacteria present because they do play a role in helping to educate our immune system. So that was a really interesting finding to show that, you know, in that case, probiotic supplementation really didn't do them any favors. And the best method for reestablishing their native microbiome was the autologous fecal transplant. So they just, you know, ingesting their own or via an enema, that reestablished things very quickly. And wait and see was sort of second best. And so, there may be risks in terms of sort of looking at it like introducing a potentially invasive species, that we don't know how many of those organisms are going to enrich. We don't know exactly where they're going to end up. So if we're taking strains of bacteria that really are supposed to be in the large intestine, but then they take up residence in the small intestine, that may cause issues. Or there was another interesting article that showed that some individuals appeared to be resistant to enrichment. So their microbiota were not affected in any way. There were no changes to the microbiome from probiotic supplementation. And that's arguably not really a bad thing because we want to have a pretty robust microbiome. Now, in most cases in healthy individuals, so people who are free of disease, taking a probiotic supplement doesn't appear to do anything. So that's one thing to think about. If you haven't been on antibiotics, you're not traveling, you haven't had any GI upset, it's sort of like taking a multivitamin when you're in a caloric excess, eating plenty of nutrient-dense foods. You're not going to have a deficit in anything. You don't need to supplement.
You're just going to have the $50 less in your pocket.
Exactly. Yes, exactly. Yeah, it's just an expense that you don't need to make. You know, spend that money on fruits and vegetables. But in individuals who have like an inflammatory bowel disease or diarrhea, or those who are, at risk of communicable infection, like upper respiratory tract infections. Those are some of the situations in which probiotic supplementation seems to have a protective effect, or it can make treatments more effective. So it's sort of an adjuvant effect, not that it's going to replace, you know, traditional treatment, but may help with the effectiveness of treatments. But then in other cases, there was a recent study that illustrated that it probiotic supplementation actually interfered with cancer treatments.
Wow.
So, yeah. So, I mean, I think we look at them as being, you know, just purely beneficial and that there's no risk involved. But, you know, there's always going to be some measure of risk. And so even if it's just financial, you know, you have to make sure that, you know, whatever probiotic supplementation you're choosing is specific to, you know, your disease state, because we don't see that all probiotics are effective for all things. And in many cases, a strain is going to be effective for just a couple of things and then nothing else. So if you take the, you know, quote unquote wrong one to, you know, prevent upper respiratory tract infection or reduce the severity, and you are really trying to affect your diarrhea, like you're just kind of wasting your money.
So this is great. So just, I guess like the takeaway from that is just because it's good doesn't mean it's good for you. Yes. And I think that's like a bigger thing for that. Now there's a lot of people and there's a lot of companies now capitalizing on the whole microbiome testing, companies like Ubiome and things like that. So, what are your candid thoughts on those, and are they really what they're hyped up to be? And not to literally throw dirt at them, but, or they're like the next like Theranos, like, you know, like the thing of like, yeah, they're just going to, you know, take a little sample of poop and take it to a lab and literally tell you your entire makeup. Because I think my fiance had it done at one point, and I think I saw the report. It kind of showed like, yeah, you're low on this, you're high on this, you're in all these different things, that this is what your diet needs to be. Like, are we really to a point to make a dietary recommendation based on that little sample of feces and or a stool sample to be able to do that?
Well, the irony is that I could give you good dietary recommendations without having to do that at all, because based on what we know now, quote unquote, you know, really the best way to support a diverse microbiome is to have a diverse plant diet. I mean, a diversity of plants in your diet, and have plenty of dietary fibers and accessible carbohydrates in your diet. Mm-hmm. And so I don't need to, you know, charge you hundreds of dollars and look at your poop to tell you that. But in terms of, you know, what we actually learn from those tests, they are, I think it's really exciting that we can do that for one thing. The American Gut Project is really one of the biggest sort of crowdsourced experiments out there. So they survey the individuals who send in their fecal samples, and from there we can make correlations, you know. Okay, so people who eat at least 30 plants in their diet tend to have really diverse microbiota. And there are actually even correlations between diversity and antibiotic use. So, and then, you know, the, whether we're eating, we can see if we can look at changes in individuals who switch from, you know, more of a vegan type diet to one that includes animal products.
Okay.
So we can see, you know, we can see some interesting trends and correlations there, but can we, you know, really get an accurate and detailed description of what's going on in the gut? Not really. These are fecal samples, and our fecal microbiome is actually different from our gut microbiome. So when we're looking at the profile of organisms in our stomach, in our small intestine, and in our large intestine, it's all significantly different. And even looking at those in the mucus layer that's really close to our intestinal cells versus the lumen, which is like the center of the hose of our intestines, we see significant differences there as well. And so there have been really very few studies that have gone through and actually sampled the lumen versus the mucus and various sites in the digestive tract. But from that, we can see that they're actually very different from the fecal microbiome. It's fairly representative of what's happening in the distal or farther parts of the colon, but that's not telling us what's happening along the entire length of the digestive tract. And then it's also going to be subject to the influences of, you know, transport being stored at room temperature for a period of time. Yeah. You know, there are going to be some bacteria that are going to bloom well in those conditions and then others that will die out. So we just have to be very aware that there are significant limitations. And there are potentially thousands of species of bacteria. And so we're not, you know, I've seen the tests that come out and we're looking at like dozens on that piece of paper because there are many that we're just not able to detect with the technology that's being used.
Okay. So again, don't waste your money. It's not necessary. We right. can make recommendations based on it to kind of like improve your gut health without necessarily thinking of not spending $50 on probiotics and not the least like actually spending, I don't even know how much that thing costs, but I'm sure it's going to be like, you know, pretty high up there.
Yeah. With the American Gut Project, I think it's only like maybe like $99. Mm-hmm. So if you have, you know, I mean, it would be fun. Like, I actually think I might do this just because it's fun and, you know, I want to like contribute to science and things like that.
Yeah.
But don't use it as like, it's not a diagnostic tool. Like, this isn't going to tell you, you know, that, oh, you have a dysbiosis and that you need to cure that. Like, this is just giving you a little snapshot of some of the big names in the gut and, mm-hmm. you know, you can support diversity just through having a lot of plants in your diet.
That's awesome. Yeah. So you posted today in one of your, I call them your epic stories because I was doing my homework, the most effective way, and I'm quote unquote, to boost your bacterial biodiversity was through dietary fiber and microbe accessible digestive, and I just changed the word in there, carbies. So if we talk, can you kind of elaborate more on this specifically to those microbe accessible digestive carbohydrates? Like, what did you refer to those specific and how can people start to implement some of this as practical recommendations to kind of change in their diet?
Yeah. So that term, I really love it because those are different from fiber. So fiber is structurally entirely indigestible by humans, and it passes through our stomach and small intestine to our large intestine, where it is then accessible to those microbes. They can ferment those fibers, and they may produce gas or short-chain fatty acids. But there are some starches that are also used by the bacteria. And actually, bacteria will use digestible carbohydrates too. So things like lactose that humans in most cases will produce, you know, the lactase enzyme mm-hmm. to break that down. Sometimes we can't. Fructose, sucrose. So, you know, there are carbohydrates, if they're present and available to those bacteria, they'll use them. But in most cases, we sequester those carbohydrates faster, really, than the bacteria can use them. And so it's a little bit of a battle between, you know, the host and, mm-hmm. and the microorganisms for those. But when it comes to things like resistant starch and fiber, we really can't do anything with those. And so they're entirely, you know, for the enjoyment, so to speak, and the nutrition of the bacteria. So one of the best books that I could recommend for people who are want to just learn about the field of gut microbiome science in a really applied way would be The Good Gut by the Sonnenbergs. So they are gut microbiome researchers out of Stanford. So they're actually, you know, performing this research. They've been in it for a very long time, really since the beginning. And they talk a lot about these, and they have a great section in that book of recipes that contain these types of foods. And, you know, it's nothing super sexy or exciting. It is just, it is a plant-centric diet. So fruits, vegetables, whole grains, they're omnivorous, and I am omnivorous. I just tend to eat, I'm ovo-pescatarian, so fish and eggs. And so you don't have to be vegan or, you know, vegetarian, but you just want to make sure that you're eating plants at every meal and a wide variety of plants. Now, in many cases, the best types of fibers for those bacteria are those that are highly fermentable, and that means that they can lead to gas production. So I don't recommend that people, you know, just rapidly increase their fiber intake, because that can lead to GI distress, especially when we're talking about these fermentable carbohydrates or FODMAPs. Mm-hmm. So a low FODMAP diet is one that's often used in individuals who have irritable bowel syndrome, but it's not intended to be a long-term diet. It's intended to be short-term elimination with retesting to reintegrate those foods back into their diet. Okay. So I just want to make that clear that, you know, even though you may experience some gas and things like mm-hmm. that, you can actually increase your tolerance to those types of foods.
Okay. So yeah, and I think like FODMAPs is something that I've come a little familiarized with. My fiance, she had a lot of gut health issues. So for example, she did FODMAPs. We found out that garlic and onions are huge like issues for her. And I've been finding a lot in many people as I work when I coach them that they complain a lot about abdominal bloating and abdominal distension. So what are some of the things that you usually find like common denominators in a lot of people that when you take it out, like things starts to improve tremendously? Because I have a lot of clients that do suffer from a lot of bloating. It's not necessarily like an IBS or something like this. It's just really severe bloating. Like I can tell you, like my fiance sometimes has, like she looks like, and she will tell you this, I'm not saying this as the team, but she says like, I look like I'm 6 months pregnant and I have pictures. So what are some of like the common denominators that you tend to see on this of the causes? And is there a relationship with your microbiome in some sort of way?
Yeah, so it's funny that you mentioned garlic and onion, because those are two that I see fairly commonly. So they're really high in inulin, which is one that's kind of a particularly, I don't want to say problematic, but it's just a very gas-causing type of fiber. And we see that it's often on like low-carb products. It is labeled as chicory root fiber. So that's just one thing to look out for. They may not label it as inulin, but that's what it is. And so that is really rapidly fermented and results in a lot of gas production. Second to that, I would say a lot of people have difficulty with lactose. They have lactose intolerance. So that's another one. And then I would say two more that are super, super common. Most people probably are familiar with sugar alcohols having a bloating, gas-producing laxative effect. And then also fructose and fructans. So I see a lot of individuals that have a hard time with high levels of fructose. And then fructan, sort of the polymer of fructose. So that's why we see, you know, like garlic, onions, and interestingly, fructans may be the real cause behind issues with non-celiac gluten sensitivity. So it's not that individuals are responding to the gluten in those products. Mm-hmm. They're actually having GI distress due to the fructans in those products.
Wow.
Okay, yeah,
so definitely there's like a lot. It sounds like there's like a kind of relationship. Now, is this is something that sometimes is innate in the individuals, like, you know, gut kind of microbiome that may be affecting this and kind of like the makeup of their gut? Or is it more sometimes like, do you think, and based on your research and based on what you know, could it be environmental and some sort of way of the way that they eat, the way that they ate when they were little, to shape up exactly what their microbiome. And the reason why I ask is because we tend to have conversations about this as, you know, how you were fed when you were little, the microbes that you were exposed to when you were growing up. For example, like my fiance grew up in a very low income family. So of course, like she didn't really have accessibility to a lot of different diversity of food. So she was very limited on some of those things. And we compared to myself, like I was more of like a medium income to like, socioeconomic status, and I did have a lot more, and you know, I can eat anything, and I've gut problems are never an issue. So do you think like there's a relationship on environmental factors and how you're brought up and the exposure to specific foods in your microbiome and your microbiota?
Absolutely. I mean, do we know a specific link or, you know, cause and effect? We really don't know what order things are occurring in, you know, so it's a chicken or the egg problem. But absolutely, you know, the way that you're born, vaginally versus C-section birth, breastfed versus bottle fed, early use of antibiotics, early exposure to pets and allergens and potential pathogens in the environment, all of these seem to shape the microbiome for about the first 3 to 4 years of life. And then things tend to be pretty stable until somewhere between 50 and 60. And then you sort of start to spontaneously lose diversity. They don't really know why that's occurring. Now, from the ages of, say, you know, 4 to 60, your microbiome stays pretty stable. You have a core that's specific really to just being a human, and then another percentage of that is individual to you. And our inter-individual differences are so significant that even if we do make big dietary changes, and say we, you know, you put three people on exactly the same diet, those dietary changes will be minuscule compared to the inter-individual differences. So it's like we're the sum of all of these things that have occurred to us over, you know, the first several years of our lives. And it's very, very hard to make measurable changes in the microbiome over time.
Okay.
So it looks like you're kind of being set up in the first few years of life for what you're going to have later down the line. Now, can we nudge things a little bit? You know, can we support a diverse microbiome and perhaps prevent the loss of diversity? Yes, it does appear that we can, because we do lose some diversity when we like stop eating fiber, for example. So we know that, you know, we can cause some deleterious changes. But are we ever going to, you know, completely wipe out the microbiome? Absolutely not. I mean, there's no evidence to say that that might happen. Now, can this potentially be contributing to, you know, the prevalence of irritable bowel syndrome and inflammatory bowel disease? Once again, we're not really sure, because although we know that changes occur in the microbiome, especially now that we have data coming out of the IHMP, they've been able to actually characterize some of the changes that occur during a flare or individuals who have inflammatory bowel disease. But we haven't been able to say what comes first. So we don't know if it's a change in the organisms causing, you know, X, Y, and Z, or if it's that it's the change in their environment that is then causing the microbes to change.
Yeah.
So, you know, with cases like that where a person seems to really respond to FODMAPs, well, it could be that they have bacteria present that are really great at fermenting. And it's not necessarily that that's a bad thing in terms of quote unquote gut health. It's just very uncomfortable. Yeah. So I think, you know, we also have to kind of look at how we're framing that experience. It's very uncomfortable, and no one should have to live, you know, with that level of discomfort. It's certainly a quality of life issue, but it doesn't necessarily mean that something is wrong, with the microbiome, or that, you know, we have dysbiosis. It could be just that, you know, there are a lot of bacteria present that perhaps were, you know, maybe somewhat starved for their desired, you know, nutrients early on, and, you know, you feed them a bunch of it, and then they have a heyday with it.
Yeah, there's so many different things that we don't know, and I feel like it's kind of like crazy to think that it ends up being like super individualized, and that's what a lot of people like don't like to hear, because like, okay, like you're saying, like there's not like this like definite answer for me, not always, and I think that's something that people really need to take away from all this. Now, I have like one more area that I wanted to cover before we kind of jump into some just quick answers to some of like the stuff that people ask me on Instagram. I guess I wanted to ask you, I get your thoughts more on like plant-based versus, you know, like people that eat consume meats and stuff like that. And I'm not going to get too much into like the super high fat and that kind of stuff. I feel like we can have an entire podcast on that. But more of like, you know, and not necessarily asking your personal preference for choosing more plant-based or lacto or vegetarianism, but more like the effect on, you know, is it really, from what you've seen, more effective from the health perspective and gut health perspective to have a diet that is like more predominantly plant-based as opposed to, you know, meat-based and you know, is there like a happy medium in between that, you know, can be reached from that, from your perspective?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I really do think that, you know, probably in terms of overall health, that some level of omnivorous is probably best for supporting a really diverse microbiome. Because then, like you said, you have kind of the best of both worlds. So we have plenty of plant diversity. Then there are some taxa that really do well metabolizing dietary proteins. Now, can you have these dietary proteins from just purely plant sources? Absolutely. So yeah, you could probably get by on, you know, vegan, vegetarian, you know, and as long as a diet is well planned and diverse, you're not going to have, you know, significant nutrient deficiencies, again, if it's well planned. But I think where we see, you know, some issues is now moving toward diets that have zero fruits and vegetables in them. That can certainly be problematic because now those bacteria are going to be starved of nutrients that they require. And instead, they will turn to towards our mucus layer and take the carbohydrates that are present there. And that can be problematic because we really want a nice thick mucus layer. It's sort of like a moat surrounding a castle. And when that moat goes dry, people can just, you know, invaders can crawl right through the dirt and get to where they shouldn't be. Okay. Again, we are sort of lacking data on the effects of digestible carbohydrates and specific proteins and specific fat sources in humans. And we run into that issue of so much inter-individual variability that like it completely masks any change. So it almost looks like the stuff doesn't really matter. That's the best answer I can give right now.
That's fine. That obviously kind of gives some people like, you know, some perspective, like, okay, like plant-based seems to be like a pretty good approach, but you know, it will depend on many other different factors and not necessarily saying like one thing is better. Like, I feel like extremisms is like what we're trying to kind of like avoid. And I feel like we live in a world where there's like cults, like there's the keto carnivore, you know, like cult where they're like, okay, this, and then there's the veganism where like, you know, any kind of like animal dietary proteins are like, you know, a big no-no and stuff. So right. I just feel like we need to kind of find some sort of like, you know, balance in between.
Yeah. Because you know, there was another, and I haven't shared this yet, but there's another study that just came out recently and they were looking at TMAO production, after, fish consumption. And it was actually still, and TMAO, you know, is like a marker for cardiovascular disease. Very high after consuming fish.
Really?
Yeah. So either the TMAO isn't necessarily a problem or, you know, it's all animal proteins and like, okay, I've got to wait and see what's going to happen. You know, it's just that, hey, we just didn't really know this until now. And so, yeah, the recommendations, I'm sure, are going to change.
So I bet from that study, there's going to be a lot of headlines, like, you know, reading, like, you know, study founds, like, fish consumption causes heart disease.
Yes, exactly. Oh, my God, I just can't wait. That's why I've been hesitant to share it. I'm like, I don't want people to take this wrong with it.
Yeah, it sounds like it. Well, this is awesome. Now, I do have some like people ask, you know, just four questions on here on your thoughts on the following. Apple cider vinegar. It seems like it was like, I feel like it was a big hype. Now it's starting to kind of die off because other things have taken their place. But, you know, your thoughts on that? I think a lot of people were taking it because of in some way or another, was actually because of gut health and digestive health. What are your, like, you know, quick thoughts on it? You don't have to go too in-depth into it.
Well, nothing is going to be more acidic than actual stomach acid. So drinking apple cider vinegar is not going to like help digest your food for you. And again, no evidence that it's supportive for digestive health or gut health. The lumen of our intestines is pretty tightly regulated in terms of pH, as it's supposed to be. So yeah, no need to drink apple cider vinegar. I think there's some weak evidence that it might help with insulin sensitivity, and that's it.
Okay. Somebody sitting here, I have a problem with lectins. I'm not sure exactly what he was referring to. Have you heard anything on lectins and gut digestion and health?
That's, again, one of those like anti-nutrients. So plants will sometimes, you know, produce various compounds as sort of a protective mechanism. Mm-hmm. I don't know of any disease state or like allergy to lectins. And probably I think it's going to be another case of, we think that it's, you know, gluten and it's actually the fructan. So we think it's a lectin problem. It's actually probably just a fermentable fiber problem.
We just blame a bigger fish and when sometimes it's just like one component of it. And I think, yeah, yes, that happens, yeah, all the time. Somebody said here, quote, like literally a quote, fucking bone broth. So what are your thoughts on bone broth? Because it costs like $40 a container, which now bone broth, you know, crazy now, comes in a powder form.
Yes.
So what's like, you know, like, why do people take it? And like, do you really need to get like the, you know, the parts of bones, you know, to be able to support gut? Because I know there's a big claim on gut health for sure.
Oh, yeah. It's so weird. I don't even know where this really comes from. I mean, I know, you know, I've looked up the research on collagen specifically. There are some studies on collagen, and I've actually had people, like credentialed people, say, hey, just look it up on, you know, PubMed or whatever. Like, you can find that there are studies. And I'm like, there are a few studies in cell culture, and if you're making all of your recommendations based on a couple of studies that haven't even been replicated just in cell culture, you need to probably revisit like what you find to be evidence based. You know, if in cell culture, colonocytes, you know, really high doses of collagen peptides may help to increase tight junction proteins. And I think that's, people are taking that and just running with it. And now it's become like, drink the bone broth because bones contain collagen, and there you can get your collagen for gut health. That's, I guess, what people are concluding. But again, there's just no evidence for that. And there's not really like a mechanism by which that would work, because it's not like if you drink collagen that it stays collagen and then is just integrated into the collagen in your body. Like, we have multiple yeah. types of collagen as well. So it just makes absolutely no sense. It's going to be digested like any other protein, maybe worse because it has really low bioavailability and digestibility score. It does not contain really any of the essential amino acids. So it's just an extrapolation, kind of the same thing with glutamine. There was like one study on glutamine in athletes. Another lab couldn't reproduce it, but of course only the first study really got a lot of notoriety. So like glutamine yeah. is another thing that people take.
Yeah, they took it and then went away with it. So mm-hmm. typical thing on research. So that is awesome. I've had a ton of fun today talking about this. There's one more section I like to do with every single one of my podcast guests. This is just so we can kind of like lighten the mood. I call it rapid fire questions. Okay. So there are like four simple things. You just need to, there's only one rule for it. You just need to answer the first thing that comes to your mind, that first to your head. You cannot think about it. Okay. They're simple. There's nothing crazy. So don't worry about it. You ready?
All right. Yes.
All right. First one, most favorite, if you could do it for the rest of your life, type of exercise, go.
Oh, lifting.
Lifting. Specific one.
Benching.
Okay. There you go. Okay. That's it. Okay, girl. I see you. I love that. That's good. All right. Second one, one book that you would recommend for somebody to literally read like on the spot, or somebody, or a book that you would gift to somebody.
The Dip by Seth Godin.
Okay, good. I've heard of it. I just never read it before. So definitely gonna have to put that on my library list. Great. Yes. A podcast you would recommend to somebody to listen to, and you have one or one that you get on often, you definitely can recommend it.
Revive Stronger with Steve Hall.
Mm-hmm. Great one for sure. Yes. That's awesome. Last one, if you were stranded on a desert island for the rest of your life, you have water availability, but you were able to choose one food to live off of until you at the end of your days, what would that be?
Peanut butter.
Okay, great. You would be surprised at the stuff I hear on this all the time, from lasagna to like mangoes to like pokeballs. Like, it's this Ooh. Is like the most fun question.
I didn't even think of like good foods. I'm just thinking of like the foods that I habitually eat all the time. Like, what's my favorite?
You get fats. You get some proteins in there. A little bit of carbs. You know, it's a good, pretty good, nutritious food. So I guess it's a good one. Yep. That's awesome. Well, thank you so much, Gabrielle, for being on the podcast here today. So how can people find you, contact you, reach out to you, get in touch with you, work with you in any kind of way? So it's like kind of plug in all the ways that people can reach out.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Instagram and Facebook, I'm VitaminPhD. And they can also email me, VitaminPhDNutrition@gmail.com. So I do coaching one-on-one through Renaissance Periodization. And I also do a different type of coaching specifically for digestive health concerns and then long-term weight management. I do that through my personal consulting, Vitamin PhD Nutrition. So awesome. Whichever they are interested in, absolutely reach out and say hi.
Well, whenever I have people with like digestive health issues, I know exactly where to send them. We live in a referral war, and we need to make sure that we refer people to the good professionals that are evidence-based practitioners. And that if you're listening to this, you need to know that you need to go and seek for people that know what they're talking about. And you, Gabrielle, know exactly what you're talking about. So,
thank
you so much for being in today's podcast. And if there's anything else that you wanted to add, we'll wrap it up.
I think that's great. I am just excited to be getting the good evidence-based word out.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Gabrielle, and have a good night.
Thank you.
You have been listening to Viva Nutrition Radio. Couple of things before you take off. If you enjoyed this episode, please, I would love to get your feedback. So feel free to drop down a review and I will be forever grateful. Also, if you like this podcast, make sure you hit the subscribe button. We have it on iTunes, Spotify, or Google Play. And lastly, if you would like to receive a freebie from me, make sure you sign up for our newsletter at www.vive-nutrition.com. See you guys in the next episode. Ciao, ciao.